We will continue the same topic. Okay. We will see the programs discussion. Okay. In the previous class, we have seen this particular program. So we need to transfer contents from 2000 location, okay, take the contents from 2000 location and add that thing to 2001 location, and then result, that is sum and carry, are stored in 2002 and 2003. So yesterday we have seen this thing, and in today's class we will see block data transfer programs, so simply called block transfer programs. So here is the question for you. First understand the question, then write the program in your own way. So the question is, write a program to transfer a block of 10 bytes of data from location 20H to location 30H. Okay. So when you see this location 20H and 30H, what you will understand? So the address 8 bits here, okay, or 1 byte, and once again the address is of 1 byte or 8 bits. So what is the meaning here? That means we are transferring this block of data from internal RAM to internal RAM locations. Okay. Now consider, okay, now I will consider the locations. Okay. The starting location is mentioned as 20H. So 20H to 29H, it is having 10 bytes of data that is to be transferred into a location starting from 30H and up to 39H. It will carry 10 bytes of data. So what is the idea, sir? How to transfer the data? The idea is very simple. Okay, take the content from 20H into accumulator, and from that accumulator transfer into 30H. So you can do this thing by using direct addressing mode, or you can do it by indirect addressing mode. So we prefer indirect addressing mode. Already I have explained the importance of indirect addressing mode over direct addressing mode. When you are transferring block, means a group of bytes, then you will definitely prefer what? Indirect addressing mode. Why? We will use first location as a reference, and we will transfer the data, and we will increment content, okay, and put it in a loop. So put in a loop of 10. So 10 times it will perform the same operation. So the block of 10 bytes will be transferred into the other desired location or destination location. That the idea is very clear. So because of that reason, we are using what? Indirect addressing mode. So I will start here. So what is the idea, sir? So if you want to use indirect addressing mode, you need to take the help of registers. Two pointer registers are available. What are those? R0, I'm using here for source. I'm using R0 as source pointer, pointing to source locations. And I'm using R1 as pointer to destination location, pointer to destination bytes. Okay. So the idea is very clear. Initialize 20H with into R0. So take this content 20H into R0. Okay. Second thing is that initialize R1 with 30H. And one more thing you need to initialize is what? How many bytes you want to transfer? You want to transfer 10 bytes. 10 is initialize 10 from the register. So I'm using registers R7. Okay. Then what I will do, sir? I will take the content in location 20H into A, and I will transfer that data into 30H, and I will put that thing into loop. So my program will be completed with that thing. So I'm starting the program. Move R7, 0H, 0AH. That means your block is of 10 bytes. So you are initializing this data into R7 register. Okay. Move R0, 20H. That means 20 is taken into R0. Move R1, 30. Okay. So what is this thing? 30. So destination location you are taking into R1. Now move A comma at the rate R1. What is the meaning here? The content available in this location pointed, whose address is pointed out by R0, that is 20. So the content available in 20 will be loaded into A. Now what I am doing? Transferring the content A into memory location whose address is pointed out by R1. That is what? 30H. Now we increment R0. Why? To point to 21H. once again I will point increment R1 so that the data should be transferred into 31H and I will put that into loop. So for that I need decrement and jump if not 0, R7 it will compare that R7 has decremented to 0 or not. If it is not 0, then it will jump to the label back. It comes here. Once again, what is happening? Move a comma at the rate R0. Now R0 is pointing to 21H. Content available in 21H is loaded into A. Content available in A will be loaded into 31H. Similarly, you will 22, 32, you will continue in the same. Suppose R0 has, it won't jump to back, simply it will jump to next instruction. The next instruction to end the program, we are using what here label is jump here. It will go into infinite loop. After some time, our processor will realize it is doing nothing. So what will happen? It will simply end up the program. Okay, is it clear? This is an example for of this program is example of transferring data from one location to another location. Both are in internal RAM. So it is one internal to internal case. Similarly, you have internal to external and external to external. So this is very clear. I'm moving to next program. Okay. Now, the question is, write a program to transfer a block of 10 bytes from location 20H to location 2000H. So the locations are clearly specifying that this is of 1 byte or 8 bits. So it is specifying internal RAM. This address is of 2 bytes or 16 bit, so it is specifying external RAM. Okay, once again the idea remains same. You need to take the content, okay, initialize this 20H with the register R0 pointer, take the content of 20H location into A, transfer it into location point into 2000. But can I use R0 R1 here? In the previous case I have used R0 and R1. Here you can use R1, but here you can't use R because R1 is of 8 bit. So to handle this 16 bit address, we need to go with DPTR, which is a 16 bit register. It is acting as a pointer to external RAM. Okay, idea remains same. Instead of R1, you will write DPTR. See, you are initializing move R7 comma 0AH, that is 10 bytes. Move R0 comma 20H, initializing R0 register at 20H location. Now instead of R1, I am using DPTR to initialize this 2000 location into DPTR. Now, at the rate R0, content of 20H is taken into A, A comma, at the rate of DPTR comma A. But you need to realize one thing here. Instead of move, I need to mention move X. Okay, what you need to mention? Move X, because you are taking content from external RAM. Move, you are loading into external RAM. Move X at the rate DPTR comma A. That means content available in A is loaded into external memory location pointed out by DPTR. Okay, now you will increment R0, increment DPTR, and what you will perform? Decrement and jump if no 0. If R7 is not 0, it will jump to the label back. Okay, you will continue this until 10 bytes are transferred into external RAM. Once again, to end the program, I am using as jump here. I think it is very, very clear. Okay, now assume the question, transfer the data from 2000H location to 20H. The program remains same. What will change, sir? This direction of arrows will change, and instead of this, you will write this instruction first. Move X A comma at the rate of DPTR and move at the rate R0 comma N. Okay, that is not a big deal. If you have understood clearly this point, you can write in your own way. So once again, see this. What I am doing here, I am initializing 20H into R0 and 2000 into DPTR, then taking content of 20H into A, content available in A into 2000H with move X, because we are transferring content into external RAM, and then I am incrementing 20 R0 that points to 21, incrementing DPTR points to 2000, and once again performing the same thing by putting that program part into our loop using DJNZ. Okay, next, I hope that was very clear. Now the toughest of the programs, or the difficult part of the programming, is what? External RAM to external RAM. Okay, why it is difficult means two addresses, okay, source address and destination address, both are of 16 bits. To handle that, you need what? 16 bit register. but you have only one 16-bit register, that is DPTR. If you are using DPTR for source as a pointer, you don't have any other 16-bit register. So what is the idea here? I will use DPTR 16-bit register to hold 16-bit address of source location, as well as I will use the same here to point the addresses of destination locations. So how? So that makes that increases simply the number of instructions. Idea remains same, concept is very easy, but number of instructions will increase. So why the instructions will increase? You will, if you follow me, I have mentioned here numbers. If you follow these numbers and if you follow my words, so it becomes very easy. Okay, I will read the question for you. It is a little blur, so listen to me. Write a program to transfer a block of 10 bytes, okay, from location 5140. Okay, the starting location is what? See here, 5140. Okay, and from this location, 10 bytes are available. Okay, what will be the last address? 5149. Okay, and destination address is what? 9384. So 9384, it will be carrying what? 10 bytes of, it will be receiving 10 bytes of data from this source locations. Okay, but it becomes difficult means if you are using DPTR here, and the same time you need to use DPTR here. So how I am using DPTR as a pointer to source location as well as destination location. So for that, first of all, I will give the idea and we will enter into program. So what I will do here, I can directly load this 5140. Okay, first see the idea. What is the idea? Take the content available in 5140 into accumulator and simply transfer it into location. But because we are accessing this thing into we are accessing with respect to external RAM, so you can't do this direct loading. Okay, for that you need a pointer. So how to use this pointer? See here, I can take this 5140 directly into DPTR, but I'm not doing that. Instead of that, I'm taking higher byte into R1 and lower byte into R1. Why? Question arises. Why, sir? Simply take this into DPTR, transfer it into A, and once again you take this into DPTR and transfer it into A. That thing will be done. You can do it by once. One data location, one data byte can be transferred here. That is easy. But what is happening, sir? For the second time, if I want to point to 5141, what you will do? Increment. If I write increment DPTR, it won't increment 5141. Because it is as the address 9384, it will increment 9385. So it will be pointing, incrementing these addresses only. Okay, to avoid that thing. Okay, to avoid that thing, to have some clarity, what I'm doing, see here, just follow the numbers. First thing, what I will do, I will initialize all the registers. Okay, I'm using registers. I will initialize registers and then I will do the process of transferring. So first, what I'm doing, considering this address 5140, taking this higher byte into R1 using move instruction, I'm taking 40 into R0 using move instruction, and I'm moving this R1 content into DPH, higher byte of DPTR, and R0 into DPL, lower byte of DPTR. So completely what is loaded into DPTR, same thing, 5140. Okay, now after loading this thing, so DPTR is pointing to which location? DPTR is pointing to 5140 location. Now I will write move X, because it is external address or external RAM. So what I will write, move X, okay, A comma at the rate of DPTR. What will happen? The content available in this 5140 location pointed by DPTR is taken into A, and then what I will do, I will hold here, I will stop here. So what is the number where I have stopped? 5. Then what should happen to 6? Okay, I will increment this thing. DPTR plus 1 means it becomes 5141. Okay, 5141 plus 1, it becomes 5141. So I am loading the same thing. So DPH will be having 51. So once again, I am loading that thing into R1. Okay, here it is what? 41. So I am loading that into R0. You can see the numbers 7 and 8. Now my DPTR is holding 5141, but I need to transfer the content available in A into this location. So I need to load DPTR with this 9384. So for that, what I will do, I will take this content into R3 and I will take the content 84 into R2. So why we are doing this R3 and R2 here, R1 and R0 separately? Because if you want to put it in a loop, it becomes very easy. So for if you want to transfer only one byte of data, there you can take here DPTR, load this into DPTR, and take here this part and load into DPTR. That will happen only for one byte of data transfer. But to put this thing into loop, you need to follow this procedure only. Okay, you have done what till now? What you have done the procedure? See, once again I will explain this. So we are done with left hand side. That is what source part. So what you have done? You have taken the location. You have loaded 51 into R1, 40 into R0. From R1 you have transferred it to DPH. From R0 you have transferred it into DPL, second and third. Then what you have done? Combined. Okay, it is available in DPTR. Now, so DPTR is pointing to what location? 5140. Content available here. So what, using the instruction move x a comma at the rate of DPTR, the content will be loaded into A. Now I am moving to destination. Before moving to that destination, I need to store the next address. Okay, 5141. So what I will do, I will increment DPTR. It becomes 5141. So I will load DPH value into R1, load DPL value into R0. Okay. So what is available? R1 and R0, 51 and 41. Okay, now I will move to right hand side part. Load R3 with 93, load R2 with 84. Take that R3 content into DPH, R2 content into DPL. Same procedure. What you have done here, the same thing is followed here. Okay. Now after combining this thing, you will incrementing, what you need to do, sir? DPTR is done completely. So DPTR is holding what? 9384. This is done. 12 part. Now what you need to do? You need to transfer content available in A into this particular location. So what is the instruction? Move x at the rate DPTR comma A. So the content available in A is loaded into A. Then you need to increment. What you need to perform? You need to increment the contents. So how you are doing? So I am incrementing DPTR plus 1, it becomes DPTR plus 1, that is 9385. So I am storing the same thing into R3 and lower byte into R2. Okay, then I will put it into loop and I will perform the operation continuously. Okay, I think it is very very clear, very simple. Okay, I am explaining the programming part. See here, move R1 comma 51H. Okay, R1. What is happening? See here, R1 is loaded with 51. Similarly, R0 is loaded with 40. Okay, this part is completed. Now move R3 comma 93H. Because these registers are separate, I can initialize and starting, or I can do later. It's up to me. So I'm doing initializing here. Move R3 and R2, and I'm initializing R7 with 10 because I need to transfer 10 bytes of data here. Okay. So move R7 comma #0AH. Okay. Now what I am doing here? Move DPH comma R1. That is R1 content 51 is loaded into DPH. Move DPL comma R0. So 40 content available in R0 is loaded into DPL. Okay. Now transferring. Now DPTR is pointing to 5140. I will transfer this content into A. How to transfer, sir? Using move x. Okay. Move x A comma at the rate of DPTR. Content available in 5140 is loaded into A. Now what I will do, I will increment this using instruction 6, so it becomes 5141. I want to store the same values into R1 and R0. So move DPH comma R1, move R1 comma DPH, move DPL comma R0. So you are done with the source side, and what you need to do, you need to perform the same operation in destination side. So what I am doing, sir, here 9384 is available as location, starting location. So what I'm doing, I'm loading, I have taken 93 in R3, 84 in R2. So I'm loading that R3 H, 84 into R2. Okay, that 84 is loaded into DPL. So what is your DPTR here? What is your DPTR? 9384. So the content available in A must be loaded into 9384 location. So using instruction move X, what I'm reading, move X @dptr, a. That means content available in A is loaded into the memory location whose address is pointed out by DPTR. What is address? 9384. Okay. Now what I need to do? I need to increment DPTR. And what I will do? I will to restore these values. To store these values, I will load this DPH value into R3 and DPL value into R2. So what you have done, sir? You have stored 93 in R3, 85 incremented value, 85 in R2. Now I will verify how many bytes I have transferred. If I have transferred 1 byte, so R7 instead of 10, it becomes 9. You will jump to back. Okay. You will perform similarly 9 times. So totally you are transferring 10 bytes of data. Okay. And you will end this by using here, SM here, label. Okay. I hope this is very clear. Okay, if you want me to explain once again, you can mention. Okay, voice is getting cracked. Okay, please let me know what I have explained till now. Is it clear, or where the voice has breaked or it has got some disturbance? You mentioned that part, I will explain once again. You can just simply mention, okay sir, you can explain this particular part once again, I will go with that. Okay. Everyone understood the program, what I have explained last program, external to external. Okay, if it is clear, I will move to next topic. Okay, everyone, if anyone having doubt in this thing, please mention. I will wait for more 30 seconds. If you have any doubt, please mention. I will explain that particular part. Otherwise, I will move to next topic, that is timings. Shailendra. Sorry. Okay, so I will be moving to next topic, that is times. Okay, so in this class I will be explaining you about timer theory. Okay, so we have timer programs. So I have mentioned in a separate video, timer theory and timer programs. So the title is timer theory. So I will explain the theory related to timers. So what do you remember about our timers? How many timers are available in our 8051? If you remember in the initial class, that is internal architecture, I have explained that we are having two timers. Okay, what is the purpose of timers? Simply to count, to produce delay. Okay, timers are almost similar to counters. Okay, sometimes we call timer as counter, counter as timer, but I will explain in this class, I will explain what is the minute difference. So what is this difference available between timer and a counter? So if you remember, we have two timers. What is the purpose of timer, sir? So I have explained example of microwave oven. Okay, in microwave oven you put the food inside, okay, and you will set the time 30 seconds. So then what is happening, you are producing a delay of 30 seconds with the help of a timer. Okay, so it will start internally counting 1, 2, 3 up to 30. When it reaches 30, immediately it will stop. Okay, so how you can produce this delay. There are two methods to produce delays. First method is what? By using software, that is NOP instruction. So if software, simply you are mentioning, if one NOP is generating 1 second delay, so you will mention 30 NOPs, or simply you put that thing into loop 30 times. What is happening? You are generating a 30 second delay. But what is happening, sir? What is the advantage of this software delay? It is mentioned as software delay because processor is generating the delay. Advantage is that it is cheaper. Okay, it will do the operation very fast. And what is the disadvantage? Processor is doing this thing. So that means it is working with only delay, so it can't perform any other operation. Now, second thing, that you can produce this same delay with the help of hardware. That is what? Using timer. If you are using timer, what is the advantage? The advantage is that the processor can perform other operations. Meanwhile, our timer will generate delay. But what is the disadvantage here? The disadvantage is that you need some extra hardware computer. Okay. So with this, you know what is the advantage of having timer and what is the disadvantage. And we are using two timers. Why we are using two timers, sir? We are using two timers because processor has informed a timer to generate a 30 second delay. Okay, it is producing that delay. Meanwhile, the processor is in need of second delay. Then the processor has to suspend its current execution and should generate the delay. So to avoid that thing, what I am doing, I am using second timer. So simply the processor can inform, okay, you second timer, please generate a delay of 60 seconds. Okay. So to continue the process of execution of our processor, we are using two different delays. Okay. So you can get an idea, sir. You can use more timers to generate more delays. But what is the disadvantage, sir? If you are using more number of timers, the circuit becomes very complex. Okay. So for that, we are restricting ourselves to only two timers. Okay. I think I have explained these things in detail in our first class, okay, introduction to our microcontrollers with the help of a micro oven. Now, what I have mentioned, the same thing is available here in theory. And one more thing, so where you can see the practical application means microwave oven is best example. And one more thing, you set an alarm in your mobile phone after 2 hours, okay. So 2 hours means it is counting seconds. Consider it is counting seconds. That means 1 hour it will be counting, okay, 60 into 60, 360 plus 360, that means 720. So it will be counting seconds. So when you reach that 720 seconds, what it will happen, it will inform the processor, okay, I have generated this delay. So according to that, what should happen? The processor should give a ringtone, okay. A ringtone should be start playing, okay. If you have set a song, that song should start playing. So who will do the playing of the song or the playing of the music? Processor will do. That means timer will generate that delay, and it will inform with the help of interrupt. What it will do, it will interrupt the processor and it will inform, I have generated the delay which you are in need of the delay. So it will generate the delay and interrupt the processor. Now what the processor will do, it will enter into ISR, interrupt service routine. It will enter into subprogram, it will move to the subprogram. That subprogram is written to generate the sound or generate the music of a song or alarm ringtone. Okay, so in that fashion we are using the timers, okay, in our mobile phone and other thing which we are not aware. Okay, you consider the example of alarm in your mobile phone. Timer will generate the delay, and after generating the delay, it will interrupt the processor. Processor will move to ISR, that means a subprogram. That subprogram will generate the ringtone. Okay, that thing will happen internally. Okay, we are using two timers. Why we are using two timers? I have mentioned this thing. And these two timers are of 16 bit. So what is the advantage of having 16 bits, sir? So if you are having only 1 bit, you can generate only, you can count only up to two things. What is the first count? It will be 0. Second count will be 1. If you are using a 2-bit counter, 2-bit counter means you, how many counts you can do? 4 counts, 00, 01, 10, similarly 3. So how I can explain this thing. If I'm having 3 bits, how many counts you can generate 2 power 3? If I'm having 4 bits, how many counts you can generate 2 power 4? Here I'm using 16 bits. That means I can generate 2 power 16. That means 65,536 counts. Okay. For that reason, we are using this 16-bit counters. Okay. And here you have learned in your digital electronics. Okay. Counters will be of two types: up counter and down counter. What is the meaning of up counter? So if I want to generate, if I want to count 5 counts, okay, then it will, if I'm using up counter, it will start counting from 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4. If I'm using a down counter, how it will count? If I want to count 5 counts, it will start counting from 4, 3, 2, 1 and 0. Okay, that is the basic thing. You know, I think you are aware of these things. So you have two counters. The counter name is T0 and T1. Both are 16 bit. And the our processor in 8051, we have a 8 bit processor. It can access 8 bits at a time. So for that reason, I have divided this into TH0 register and TL0 register. Okay. And T1 is also divided as TH1, TL1. So what is this TH? Higher byte of timer 0, lower byte of timer 0. Okay. Suppose I want to give, it is a 16 bit register, T0 is a complete 16 bit register. If I want to count 5, okay, if I want to count 5, so what I will mention, sir, I will give as 0005. So in TH0, I will mention 00, in TL0, I will give 00. How I can do that? By writing the instructions move TL0, hash 05 and move TH0, hash 00. Okay, so in this fashion, you can generate 5. Counts, delay of 5 seconds. Consider one count is 1 second, so you can generate a delay of 5 seconds. Okay, so all these things are SFRs. Okay, this TH0, TL1, TH1, all these are SFRs. So, 4 SFRs are available here. So, in our timer topic, you will come across 6 SFRs. What are the 6 SFRs you are going to learn here? TH0, TL0, TH1, TL1, TMOD, and TCON. So totally we have 21 SFRs. Out of that, you are including 6 SFRs in timer topic. That means this timer topic is a huge topic. Okay, so which is including 6 SFRs. Okay, so we have an assumption that a timer will count 5 delays. If you are using an up counter, it will count from 0, 1, 2, 3 and up to 4, but that thing won't happen. See, I will explain that thing. You need to understand. In our counter register, which is of 16 bit, what I have given using the instructions in previous slide, TL0, hash 05, move TH0, hash 00. That means what you have given in a counter register, you have mentioned 005. That means you are interested to count 5 counts or 5. You need to generate a delay of 5 seconds. Consider one count for 1 second. I will take this example throughout our timer topic. Okay, so it won't count from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, but it starts counting from 6. You have mentioned 5, it starts counting from 6, 7, 8. It will count up to what number, sir? It will count up to 4 Fs. Okay, FF, FF. Then what will happen? It will indicate that it has overflown. That means all Fs plus 1 means it will generate a carry. That means overflow has occurred and it will move to 0000. So that means this concept of moving from all 4 Fs to zeros is called timer overflow. Okay. So it will mention that overflow has generated and it will interrupt. That means the delay has generated and it will interrupt the processor. So what I should do, sir, if I want to generate 5 delays, should I mention in the counter register as 0005? No, I should not mention that thing. But instead of that, what I should mention, sir? I should mention, see here, if I want to generate a count of 5, so for down counter, it will start from 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. It is very clear. But if I'm using an up counter 5, so it will start from 6, 7, 8, and it will count up to FF, and it will overflow. And how that overflow is indicated using an overflow flag, TF0 overflow, it will set, TF0 will set and it will interrupt the processor. Okay, this thing will happen. So to avoid that thing, simply it is more than 5. So if you want to count 5 counts, what should be done? So I will go from last address. So what is the last maximum possible address? It is 4f's. If I want to count 5, I will see 4f's minus 1 plus 5. So why, sir? Why I am doing that thing? If you are giving 4f's minus 5 means it will start with 5, 4f's minus 5, 4f's minus 4, you will come up to fff. So it will be counting indirectly 6 counts. Okay. So to avoid that thing, if you want to count only 5, what is the formula? 4f's final value minus required or the desired value plus 1. Okay. All 4f's minus 4. So it will be what? FFFB. So it will count FFFB, FFFC, FFFD, FFFE, and FFFF. That means you have generated what? 5 counts. Okay. After that, overflow will occur. So the flag TF0, okay, TH0, sorry, the TF0 flag will set and it will interrupt the processor. Similarly, if you want 9 counts, what will you do, sir? You will select all 4Fs minus 9 plus 1, that is all FF minus 8. So FF, F is what, sir, last bit, consider this last one. F is what, 15, 15 minus 8 is what, 7. So 15 minus 8 is 7. So where you will start? FF, F7. Similarly, FF, F8, you will continue up to FF, FF. So what is happening? You have selected 9 counts. Okay. After counting these 9 counts, what will happen? The flag will set, TH0 flag will set, and it will interrupt the processor. Okay. So I have derived a formula here. Count to be loaded is equal to what? Maximum count minus your desired count plus 1. So you have taken the example, what? 9 counts. So what you have mentioned? Maximum count is FF minus 9 plus 1. Okay. So it is, this formula is applicable for T0 as well as T1. Why? Because both are up counters. Up counters, for an up counter, you need to give the count value in this form. Okay, in this form. Maximum count minus your desired value plus 1. Okay. Now, what is happening, sir? Okay. After getting the desired count, what is happening? So I have mentioned for 5 counts. So where I will start, sir? FF, FF minus 5 plus 1, that is FFFB. So I will start with FFFB, FC, FD, FE, and FF. Then what is happening, sir? It is move. Overflow is generated. Overflow is generated means TF0 flag will set. TF0 flag will set. When the flag is set, it will interrupt the processor. See here, TF0 has set, it become 1, and it is interrupting the flag. Now, the processor is at this location. It will suspend current execution and it will move to ISR. Okay. ISR is what? A small program. So similar to your alarm. Okay. So that, to generate the ringtone, to produce the music, the program is available here. So it will generate the music, it will play the ringtone. And after completion of the ringtone, what will happen? It will come back to this thing and it will continue. But what will happen, sir? After returning from this thing, if this TF0 is set, once again, what it will see? After returning, it will see, okay, TF0 is set. Once again, it will jump to ISR. So to avoid that thing, what I will do, sir? When I see TF0 equal to 1, I will move to ISR. While moving to ISR, processor will reset TF0. Okay, TF0 will become 0, and then we will move to ISR, complete the ISR, generate the ringtone. Okay, come back and it will continue in the normal execution. I think it is very, very clear. So what should we do, sir? If you want to generate 5 counts, a delay of 5 seconds, you need to load what? FF, FB. So it will count up to FFs. Then overflow will generate. That is indicated with the help of a overflow flag, TF0. It will set, and when it is set, it will interrupt the processor. When it is when the interrupt has generated, processor, what it will do, it will suspend current execution. It will jump to the ISR. While jumping, it is resetting this TF0 overflow flag and moving, providing service to this interrupt, and it will return back and it will continue the normal execution. Okay, I think it is very, very clear. One thing to understand here, so to change the counts after 1 second, so I have mentioned what, if I want to get 5 counts, that means a delay of 5 seconds. So who should change the count from 4 to 3, 3 to 1, and 1 to 0? So there should be some person to trigger or mention that you need to change from 4 to 3. Okay, so that job is done by our clock. So for every clock pulse, so this count will be triggered. That means from 4 to 3, 3 to 1, that triggering is done with the help of clock. Okay, you will supply the clock frequency here, okay, of 1 second. So for every 1 second, what will happen? If you have selected rising edge, for every second the rising edge will occur. So when rising edge occurs, it starts changing the count from 4 to 3, 3 to 2, 2 to 1 and 1 to 0. In this fashion you will do that thing, that is done by our clock. Okay, now coming to this timer and counter. So timer and counter, almost they are same. Why they are same, sir? So counter will also undergo the same process. Okay, so if you consider this as a timer, what will happen? Based on triggering pulse, counts will change. Okay, after getting the desired number of counts, that means desired delay, it will generate interrupt. Okay, it will the processor will provide service and it will come back. So this thing will happen in counter as well as in timer, both the things are same. But in counter you mention that you have achieved this desired counts, but in timer you say you have achieved the desired delay of this 5 seconds. Okay, in counter you say I have achieved the desired counts of 5, and then it will interrupt the processor. Same thing will happen. But what is the difference, sir? Okay, to know the difference, there is a minute difference. So for that I will take an example. So the same device, it will act as timer, and the same device, it will act as counter. So if the device is acting as a timer, what it will do, it will generate delay. Okay, it will be giving importance to time. Okay, it is acting as timer, so it will give importance to delay. For that I will take an example. Okay, I will ask a student, okay, you please go to our Basar railway station and count the number of trains passing Basar station in 1 hour. Okay, please listen, please concentrate here. I am asking a student, okay, consider the CR. I am asking our CR to please go to our Basar railway station and stand for 1 hour and count the number of trains passing the railway station. So what will happen, sir? He will wait for 1 hour. Okay, his task is to wait up to 1 hour and count the number of trains. So in that period, he may count trains or he may not count anything. Okay, but the task is what? After 1 hour, he will come back to our class. Okay, he will say, sir, you have mentioned to wait at that station for 1 hour. That time has completed and I am back to our class. Okay, so that means he is giving importance to time. Okay, it is. So he has waited for 1 hour, that delay has generated. Okay, when you are giving, when this device is giving importance to time to generate the delay, it is acting as timer. Okay, now I am asking the same CR, okay, to go to railway station, but the question is different now. To go to the railway station, Basar railway station, and count 100 trains. Okay, count, okay, Basar, the frequency is less, so I am asking him to count 10 trains. I have not mentioned any time here. So what is importance given here? Importance is given to count. He should definitely count 10 trains has passed the Basar station and then he will come back to our class. So what he will do, sir? One train may come immediately when he has started the count. Okay, after 1 hour, next train may come. After 10 hours, next train may come. So irrespective of time, he should count 10 trains. Okay, so it may take 1 hour, 10 hours or 15 hours or 20 hours. That is, we are not worried about time. So when we are giving importance to count, so this particular device is acting as a counter. Okay, so that is the difference. So this is how we understand that the same device is acting as a timer, giving importance to time. This same device is acting as a counter, giving importance to count. Okay, but how the processor will understand? Okay, he can't understand these examples. Okay, so there should be some definition. Okay, standard textbook definitions, I will explain that. So here there are examples, but I don't think these things are necessary. Okay, I will go to our timer, the difference between timer and count. Okay, so here with respect to clock, there is a difference. If clock is a fixed frequency, then that device will be acting as a timer. That means it will work with specific clock. So for every 1 second, clock will be showing rising rates, it will count based on that. Okay, that is what giving importance to time. So it is acting as a timer. Okay. Next thing is what? Clock is of variable frequency. That means the example what I have taken of counting trains. So the trains will be having different frequency. So in one particular hour, that is from 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock, the train frequency is zero. From 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock, the train frequency may be high. So that will be varying. The example is what? The count of the trains will be different in different hours. That means you are using variable frequency. So when you are using a clock of variable frequency, that will act as counter. When you are using the clock of fixed frequency for this device, it will act as timer. Okay. What is the example, sir? Microwave oven. Okay. So for that, you are supplying a constant clock. So one clock cycle is of 1 second. So if you have mentioned 30 seconds, so what will happen after exactly after 30 seconds, it will switch off. The timer will display that it has generated a delay and it will switch off. Okay. Then what the example we have taken, sir, the clock example of your train, and you can take some other examples. Cash counting machine. Okay. In banks, you can see this thing. So when you place the notes in the bank counting cash counting machine, start counting and it will display the number. How it counts? So there will be some infrared rays, IR rays. So when the notes cutting that IR ray, it will generate a pulse. Okay, based on that pulse. Okay. So based on the pulse, okay, see, so based it is the notes are cutting IR rays. Based on that, when IR ray is blocked by the note, it will generate a pulse. So how many number of blocks? So based on that, it will display the count. Okay, so that machine is acting as a counter. Okay, you can take another example. In shopping malls, you will enter, before entering the shopping mall, you can see a wooden door like structure. You will be entering in that. So you don't know that it is counting the number of persons entering in the shopping mall. Okay. So how it is done, sir? So there IRA is available. So when you are crossing that wooden structure, you are blocking the IRA. So when you are blocking a logic low signal or logic high signal based on your designing, so that pulse will be generated. On how many number of pulses are generated, based on that count, we can decide how many number of persons have entered the shopping mall in a day or in an hour. Okay. Now, so we have in internal architecture diagram, you can see we have two timers, T0 and T1. So this T0 is acting as a timer as well as a counter. This T1 is acting as timer as well as counter. So when it will act as timer and when it will act as counter, to see that. So we have oscillator frequency. So we are using an oscillator of 12 megahertz frequency. What is happening? So it is given to our microcontroller, but for our timer operations, we are using what? 1 megahertz frequency. So it will be divided by 2 and you will get 1 megahertz frequency. That 1 megahertz frequency is what? Fixed frequency. So if I'm supplying 1 megahertz frequency to this T0 and T1, what is happening? These two timers, T0 and T1, are acting as timers because frequency is what? Fixed. Okay. Now, if I want to supply variable frequency, we have seen in our internal architecture diagram that you have pins, T0 and T1 pins, okay, hardware pins. So using these hardware pins, you can supply variable frequency to T0 and variable frequency to T1. So when you are supplying variable frequency to T0, it will be acting as counter. When you are supplying variable frequency to T1, it will be acting as what? Counter. Okay. Suppose I am supplying 1 megahertz frequency, fixed frequency to T0, it will be acting as timer. And if I am supplying variable frequency to T1, it will be acting as counter. Okay. So based on this particular difference, what is the major difference? Clock. If the device is getting constant frequency, that will act as timer. If the device is getting a variable frequency, it will act as counter. To get the variable frequency, we should go for external source. To get the constant frequency, we are getting from internal, that is from microprocessor of 1 megahertz frequency. So this is the basic difference between a timer and a counter. Okay, this is how you understand the difference, and this difference is necessary to understand timing programs. Okay, timer programs. So one more example is available. I will explain that example. Okay. So in our industries, you can use this thing. So a machine will be available. It will be generating some products. Okay. So that products are placed on a conveyor belt, and here a container is available to handle up to 100 products. So what will happen? We will place a transmitter here, a receiver here. Basically, the receiver will be a photocell. That means whenever light falls, will generate a pulse. Okay. Continuously, it will be generating a voltage. So you will, this machine will generate a product and it will place on the conveyor belt. So what is happening? The product, when it is crossing this light, it will block. So when it is blocking, it will. So whenever this transmitter is transmitting the light and the receiver should receive the light, but when the product is blocking this, what will happen? It won't receive any pulse. So it will generate a different voltage. So I am taking that different or odd voltage as a pulse, and I am counting the number of products. So after reaching the 100 pulses, that means this container is full. What should happen, sir? Immediately, this container should be moved forward direction, and then a new container or empty container should be placed. So how it will happen, sir? Once again, the same thing. Okay. So I will give these pulses to a, these pulses as clock to our counter. So I am designed. I will mention here 100. Okay. I will mention here 100. So what will happen after reaching 100 count? What it will do? It will interrupt the processor with the help of what flag, sir? TF0 flag. Okay. So what is happening here, timer overflow flag will be generated. It will interrupt the processor, and while moving to this ISR, it will reset. So what is this ISR, sir? This ISR is a program which is written to move this container forward or backward and place a new container in this position. Okay, so this is your ISR program. So what will happen after moving this new container here? What you will write, sir? You will come back once again, and the processor will do the normal execution. And here once again, this, okay, transmitter and receiver do their own part. Machine will send 100 products. Once again, if you have reached 100 products, what you will do? Once again, you will generate an interrupt to the processor. It will generate, it will move to the ISR. Using this ISR, you can move this container forward direction or backward direction. Okay. So with this, today's class ends. So if you have any doubts, please mention. Okay. So in between, so the voice clarity was missing. So if any part you didn't hear with clarity, please mention. I will explain it once again. And one more thing, if you have any doubts in any part, you can mention. I will clear the doubts. Okay, if everything is clear, you can mention clear and clear or end. I will end this session. If you have any doubts, please ask.